I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, I'm gonna let the reason out that his love goes on forever. I'm gonna take it all the way.
Hey, welcome back to the Maple Minute this Thursday, October 28th, 2021. I'm Pastor Bill, and today we're going to talk about the fact that God doesn't do stereotypes. You know, I just came back recently from my son and his fiance getting married. He got to perform the ceremony. And I was thinking, as I was contemplating their marriage ceremony, I was thinking about mine. We're coming up on our 30th anniversary, which doesn't seem like it was that long ago that we walked the aisle, but it was. But what I've learned, and one of the things I've learned over the years, and I've learned so many truths through marriage, but one of the things I've learned is that humans, by nature, are detailed. There are so many things about it. We are convoluted, we are complex, we are intricate. We are detailed by design. And it's because God made us complicated on purpose. And I'm not saying that as a bad thing. That's a good thing. God didn't make us to simpletons. God made us very complex people. And what we have to understand is that we are a lot more complicated than we sometimes let on. We can't sum up our lives with one word, even though so often we do that. We tend to label ourselves with these one-word labels. You can't reduce your identity to a single term or phrase. But I'm sad to say, we do that all the time. We say things like, well, I'm a failure, I'm an addict, I'm a divorcee, I'm a single parent, I'm all alone, I'm this, I'm, you know, whatever. And even things like, I'm a mess. And sometimes we say it to be funny, but so often we label ourselves, and I want you to know, God doesn't do that. Have you ever stopped to think about that? God doesn't sum us up with a single label. So why do we do that? Over in Psalm 139, David wrote, and these verses are usually used talking about topics about when life is begin, at conception, things like that as the proof text, but think about them in a different area. Psalm 139, verse 13, David wrote, "For you created," he's speaking about God, "for you created my inmost being, the inner person. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well." Verse 17, he goes on to say, "How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them." And he's talking about all the different things God thinks of him. He finishes out in verse 18. He says, "Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you." And what I don't get here is so often we tend to set a single label on ourselves: failure, loser, and you know, just so sad. And we start that sometimes at an early age. You know, God made us wonderfully complex. God loves our levels and our layers, just like an onion. You could peel back the layers of who our personalities are and the complexity of what we are. Now, I'm not calling you onions. I'm just saying that's a comparison. But God delights in all of our details, is what David teaches us. His thoughts towards us can't be counted, calculated, or quantified. That's what David is really trying to get across here. See, every piece of us, every facet of who we are and who we are becoming is on God's mind all the time. I love that. It's so true. You know, when you're not thinking of God, God's still thinking of you. But here's the problem. You know, often we pick out one detail from our lives and make it our identity. We fail, and I saw that in sports as a coach. I saw that in the classroom as a teacher, and I see it as a pastor so often when I talk to people and they define their lives by one failed relationship, one failure in their moment of weakness and sin. And we tend to make that our whole life, but I want you to know that's not our whole life. It's a detail. It is one facet, one component, one piece of who we are. But I want you to know, God's view of us is so much bigger than a single word or detail. He doesn't define us from one failure or even a string of failures. He never categorizes us based on who we are who we are not. I should start to say who we are not, or what we can't do, or where we've messed up. See, God sees the whole picture. He understands us better than we do, and he loves us. That's what we talked about last time. He loves us completely and profoundly. You can't get God to love you any more than he already does. See, sometimes people think the Bible is written to tell us about what to do and what not to do. It's a list of rules and regulations. But It's not a rule book with a bunch of it's a book of history with a bunch of stories and poetry thrown in, but that's a very shallow view. See, the Bible isn't primarily just about avoiding sin. In fact, it's really about knowing God and being known by Him. It reveals the heart of God towards us, and it shows us what He thinks of us, how He responds to our weaknesses, and what His plans for are for you and for me. Think about this. God knew you before Jesus ever was crucified. That'll blow your mind. And yet, He still died for us. As I said last time, Paul would be clear to mention this, that while we were still sinners, in the very act, that term brings about that very active presence of sinning. While we were sinning, think about this. Well, I'll bring this up on Sunday, but think about this. The activity of sinning was happening while Jesus was on the cross, and yet Jesus still died for all those sins. We need to stop oversimplifying ourselves. We need to quit underestimating the value and beauty intrinsic to ourselves and our lives. We need to avoid defining ourselves with a word or two. Instead, we should start listening to God's voice. His thoughts about us are magnificent. And His love is so amazing that the most well-known verse in all the Bible is John 3:16. For God so loved the world, that's you and me, even with all of our difficulties and all of our faults. So as we think it through and think it over, let me ask you a couple of questions to ponder. With what words or phrases do you tend to sum up your life? Are they positive or negative? Do you think God agrees? Those are some heavy-duty questions. And once again, I encourage you, find someone else who you trust, a good accountability partner. Maybe it's your spouse. Maybe it's a family. You can have family time and sit down and discuss these. Sometimes we do define ourselves, even within the family. And it's tragic, parents, just so you know, when your kids develop that habit of defining themselves by one word early on, it limits them greatly. Don't let them do it. Help them to understand who God thinks about of them. Secondly, based upon what you know about Jesus and His unconditional love, what are some of the thoughts God has about you? It's always helpful when we start thinking about, what does God really think about us? You know, God does not have an angry bone about us. I was trying to talk to somebody this last week, and they kept telling me about all the things, and they were a Christian. They kept telling me about all the things that God was judging them in their life. And I had to remind them that according to Romans chapter 8, verse 1, that there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. You see, the price of your sins has already been paid. You can't pay it again. So to act like you're paying a price for a sin you created and committed isn't true. There are always physical results of bad choices, but your sins are already judged on the cross. We sang last Sunday in one of the great songs, Jesus paid it all. Not part of it, all of it. Thirdly, is it hard for you to believe all the good things God thinks about you? If it is, why or why not? Those are some really good questions to ask yourself. Maybe you're a person who likes to journal. This would be a good question to write down in your journal and then write your thoughts. Maybe you don't want to share with anybody else, but it'd be good to be honest with yourself. Take time to spend time in deep thought about who God is and what He thinks about you. And thanks once again for joining us on today's Maple Minute. His love reaches to the highest mountain. His love stretches to the lowest valley.